Peter Burwash, Canadian Davis Cup tennis pro, now runs the world's largest network of tennis professionals, staffing more than 100 international resorts. Logging more than 2 million air miles annually, Peter's reputation for his energy and vitality has made him a major speaker at health conferences around the world.
If everybody had a nose across the USA, then everybody'd be served like California. You'd see them wearing their baggies, Huarache sandals too, a bushy, bushy blonde hair, serving USA. You'll catch them serving at them
inside, outside, USA.
Ventura County line.
Now we want to talk tonight about this area for the men. A man has absolutely no excuse whatsoever for having any fat on their stomach, even a quarter of an inch. Men and women put on weight differently. It's why a lot of times you'll talk to a husband and wife couple, and the woman will say, "My husband has perfect thighs, but he's got a huge stomach." Well, men will only basically put weight on in their stomach area. A man occasionally will put weight on when they get the second or triple chin, but that's a rarity. What men have to realize is that this is a depository area. What's the first exercise a man does when he gets some extra fat on his stomach? Sit-ups. And he starts cranking out sit-ups up every morning. He gets very conscientious. He gets 100, 150, 200. And he gets this incredibly cast-iron stomach. But the lump of marshmallow is still on the outside. You will never lose. You could do 10,000 sit-ups a day, and you will never lose your stomach. Women, on the other hand, put weight on in five places. We'll review them. Some of you have already been through it, but we'll just double check it. First of all, it goes on the backs of the thighs. Secondly, it goes on the sides of the thighs. Third, on the hip area. Fourth, on the stomach area. And fifth, on the arms. So when you see a woman who's driving along and her arm is out the window, and you see a fat arm, you don't have to look at the rest of her. She's got to stage five. All right? Now, what women don't realize is, by the time she's got to stage five, she's really concerned with fat on her thighs. So she wants to get it off her thighs, but it's got to come off in reverse order. So when a woman starts losing weight, it comes off in her arms first, then her hip area, then her stomach area, then her thighs. Now, women, unfortunately, have been duped into a lot of fake reducing machines. What's the famous one all over the world? Is the butt rubber. And they get this machine, and the instructors are very clever, because what they do is they'll come out and they'll say, "Oh, Mrs. Smith, look at this. You now have 41 inches. And Mrs. Smith will get on this machine, and the machine will rub away like crazy, and the instructor comes out and measures it, and it's 40 and a half inches. And Mrs. Smith thinks he just lost a half inch. The problem is with these machines is what they really do is they force the water to the center of the body. But when the tide comes back out, Mrs. Smith's back to 41 inches. So there is no simple machine that will help you lose weight. They have these machines advertised on television where you can sit and watch TV and it'll lift your arm. It doesn't work that way. It's not going to come off. The only way you lose weight effectively is through an aerobic type activity. Now, unfortunately, the word aerobics was associated with dance classes. So all the guys said, "That's for my wife or for my girlfriend." Aerobics means with oxygen. So any activity where you have to take in oxygen over a continuous period of time is defined as an aerobic activity. Running, walking, bicycling, swimming, cross-country skiing, and aerobic dance class, they are all aerobic activities. We want to talk about the difference between an aerobic activity and an anaerobic, which means without oxygen. A 100-yard dash is an anaerobic activity. When you sprint 100 yards, you probably don't take any oxygen. If you do, it maybe one breath. On the other hand, a lot of people, and particularly men, tend to overwork, particularly in the age category of, say, 40 to 60, because they grew up with the theory, no pain, no gain. That doesn't count anymore, because it's now been proven that if you get your heart rate up too high, then it becomes the law of diminishing return, whereby it's not as effective and you start feeling dizzy because you're using up blood sugar instead of muscle sugar. But let's talk now about an aerobic activity. What is a good aerobic activity if you do it? How long? The intensity. First of all, how long? Nobody knows what is the most beneficial for you. They're coming up, they thought, minimum 12 minutes. Then they went to minimum 15. Some say 20, some say as high as 28 or 30. What they do know now is that about the ninth minute, your body switches over to burning up fat. So the majority of activities, an aerobic activity, if you can get in the range of a 15 to 20 minute aerobic activity every day, and for a lot of us in the business world, that is an attainable time frame. Men and women put on weight differently. Women put weight on the outside almost immediately. A lot of times you hear women say, geez, I just ate that chocolate cake and I feel like it's pasted to my thighs. That's a fact. I mean, they will put weight on instantly because women have 13% essential body fat. They start off with that. Men only start off with 3%. So the way men put on weight is they fill up inside. So what a man does before any fat appears on the outside, they fill up all of their muscles and arteries with fat. That's why when a quarter of an inch appears on your stomach, you are now defined as a cardiac time bomb. Now, last year, pardon me, in 85, we lost 80,000 men between the ages of 30 and 35 from a heart attack. 80,000 men between the ages of 30 and 35. That, it dropped after that, by the way, when you got into the 35 or 40, because they started to get a little bit more serious about it. But the important thing to keep in mind is that if you have fat on your stomach, you are clogged up inside. Not so for women necessarily, but for a guy, yes. So how do we get it off? We work through this aerobic activity with our heart rate at a certain zone. So let's say we're working at 80%. That gives us about 152. Now, what's that number? That means our heart rate, if we're going to exercise in the target zone, see that nice black strip there? Well, you want to work in the range for your age. About 150 beats a minute. We'll round it off. Now, what do we want to do here? We don't want to take our pulse for a full minute. This is a mistake that people make, or even for 30 seconds. Because the way your heart goes is, at the end of exercise, it stays up for a few seconds, starts dropping almost immediately, levels off, comes back down, and then goes back to normal. By the time 30 seconds is up, you've probably had your heart rate drop anywhere from 10 to 30 beats. So the important thing here is that you take it shortly after exercise. The magic number is for 6 seconds. Why is 6 seconds very nice? Because if you take it for 6 seconds, then you're only going to have to figure 15 beats in 6 seconds, or 150 beats in 60 seconds. So most of you, looking at your age and looking at your condition today, would probably be working anywhere from 13 to 15 beats in a 6 second time frame. So right after your activity, you take your pulse. And remember, you don't take your pulse with your thumb, because there's an extra beat in most people's thumbs. You take it, put it on your carotid artery, or you can check around your wrist. One of the best ways is to wrap it around under, and it'll be up there. If you're moving, right now it may be tough to find, particularly if you've got a little extra fat in there or on your wrist, but most people can find it at the end of the exercise. It'll be going boom, 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 like that. And that's the activity, that aerobic activity you want to work in that range for approximately 15, 16, 17, 18 minutes. How intense? The best criteria is you should be able to carry on a normal conversation with someone next to you. If you're running with anyone or doing it, you should not be struggling like this. That means it's probably anaerobic. You're above the aerobic activity. Carry on a normal conversation. You should not feel lightheaded. It shouldn't hurt. If it hurts, your body's telling you something. That old theory of go till it hurts and then go some more is no longer part of the theory of proper conditioning. How often should you exercise? Well, if you like the condition you're in today, if you're totally satisfied, you exercise 3 times a week. If you don't do X 3 times a week, if you go once, twice, or zero, you're going to get worse. If you want to improve the condition, it has to be 4, 5, or 6. Take a day off. 4 or 5 for business executives is fine. You got to make that commitment. You made a commitment to eat for the rest of your life, right? So just make a commitment to exercise. What people have to realize is that this body is built to exercise. When they build an airplane, it's not built to sit on the ground, it's built to fly. This body is built to move. The heart is 100% muscle. And those of you who broke a leg or arm when you were younger or older or whatever, you know that what happens to that muscle when it doesn't get exercised, it atrophies. So you want to make sure that you understand the principle of exercise. The body is built to exercise. It needs it. It feels good. When you exercise, what happens? Why do we feel good at the end of exercising? Because we got a little hormone called norepinephrine. It's called the happy hormone. It's released into our body. We have that euphoric feeling. It is an integral part of our everyday activity. Now, we've become a very lazy society. You ever watch people when they're driving their car in a shopping center? They'll drive round and round around trying to get that spot that's 2 or 3 slots away from the door. Park way down the road. Walk. If you're going to dinner, don't use the valet parking. Park further away so you will at least walk. At the end of eating, it's critical that you get up and do some sort of movement. 80% of heart attacks occur within the first hour after eating. Interestingly enough, another statistic, 80%, not correlated, of the heart attacks occur at home. Usually, what do we do at home? What do we see home as? A place to rest. It's very important that right after eating, that's why people, there was an interesting statistic done at Stanford Medical School, and they found that those people who owned dogs were in much better shape than those who didn't, because the dog usually needs a walk. So those who go out and walk their dog, plan it right after dinner. Your dog's got a great heart. It's meant to have. You need to make sure that you get out and continue to exercise. Don't sit down. One of the most dangerous things you can do is eat and go to the lazy chair. Plan your activities. Very, very important. Incorporate into your daily activities some form of exercise, whether it's just walking. Walking is a wonderful form of exercise. If you're going to do it as an aerobic activity, you want to walk at 120 steps a minute. And that's a good clip. 120 steps a minute. Some people don't like running. A lot of people don't like running, actually. Some do. But find the activity that's good for you. Swimming is not a bad activity. The one problem with swimming is that if you do it a lot, it tends to have what's called the mammalian effect. They did a good study on Olympic swimmers and Olympic high jumpers and Olympic hurdlers and the whole string, and the fattest were the swimmers. Swimmers tend to lay down a little bit more fat than their counterpart. However, if you're not doing it all the time, it is a wonderful activity. It's a great activity, particularly if you have lower extremity problems, bad knees, bad hips, bad ankles, because of the buoyancy factor. So then you can go ahead and use it as a good aerobic activity. Bicycling is a fantastic exercise. Probably one of the best you can have. The difficulty that we have today is that you can't go bicycling everywhere. Cars hit you, they push you off the road. So we don't have that opportunity. That's why stationary bicycles have become fantastic to exercise. One of the things now I think we're going to see more and more of are bicycles in hotels. We're going to see them more as part of the everyday activity. If I had a corporation where there was enough room, and one of the things we're considering doing, I would make sure, and if you had any access to shower facilities, get it in your office, because 20 minutes, half hour bicycling is going to increase. That's been a proven statistic. If you can just get the physical activity at lunchtime or something, your productivity will go way up. It is worth every bit of the investment. And you may want to make a note here. There is a new bicycle out on the market called the PTS Turbo 1000. It's a bicycle, you may have seen the ads, where you can actually sit back. One of the problems is if you sit up on a bicycle, you get tired. You're leaning forward all the time. If you've got a bad back, it's very uncomfortable. This, you sit back in a very comfortable chair. It's contoured for the shape of your back. You can turn on your television and watch it. And let me tell you something. I got on that thing and my heart rate went from 60 to 120 in 30 seconds. No bicycle can do that. All right, let's talk now a little bit about the concept of health as it applies to the other aspect, namely proper food intake. Exercise is no mystery. It's not something that you have to get a lot of complicated, or you don't have to have a lot of knowledge. Just do it. Try to get out, but understand your best activity is aerobics. Now, we look at health, and as I mentioned at the beginning, it breaks down into two. We've got the exercise factor, which many people are familiar with. Now we've got the nutrition side of it. This is an area that is really very fascinating, because suddenly we're starting to realize that what goes into our body has the greatest single influence of anything on our overall health. For some reason, people have become very conditioned to a certain lifestyle of eating. And anything that goes against that lifestyle tends to be labeled radical. We're going to talk tonight about how nutrition really and truly affects you. Let's take a look at our blood vessel. If only we could cut ourselves open and not have a scar, sew ourselves back up, and take a look at what we look like inside, this would be an incredible motivator. Our vessels should be three things. They should be flexible, elastic, and clean. FEC. Flexible, elastic, and clean. If you took a look at the average 35-year-old in America today, both men and women, they have inflexible arteries. They have lost a lot of their elasticity, and they certainly aren't clean. Blood is the river of life. Many of you may have heard of that phrase before. And the health of your body is directly related to how clean this artery is, or your blood, your vascular system. Now, a lot of you have heard cholesterol. And so people are frightened of this word cholesterol. You shouldn't be frightened of the word cholesterol, because without it, you'd have some big problems. Your brain wouldn't function that well if you didn't have cholesterol. It's a vital part of your sexual organs. It is very important that people understand there are certain things here that all of a sudden people say, I don't want to eat anything with cholesterol in it. Well, what you want to understand is that too much cholesterol causes some problems. Cholesterol basically comes from animal products, from meat, fish, poultry, eggs, dairy products. That's where cholesterol comes from. Cholesterol does not exist in your fruits, grains, and vegetables. So when you put animal products in your system, cholesterol comes down. It has a tendency to hook on to the inner lining of the artery or the veins. What happens is now we get what is called atherosclerotic buildup, and I'll show you that a little bit better on the screen. But the atherosclerotic buildup occurs. What's in our blood that's pretty darn important? Oxygen. It's important for an athlete, or it's important for all of you. If you aren't getting, if this area is smaller and you're not getting enough oxygen to your system, things shut down. Your body shuts down. Physically, mentally, emotionally. And one of the things here that when people haven't yet come to appreciate how valuable just having your arteries clean, what it does for you mentally, to be able to have that constant flow of oxygen. Most people today in America, by 3 o'clock, their biggest movement is this. They spend most of their time waiting to get off work because they're worn out. They've had it. And that's simply because they are not getting, they're tired. You see people nodding off all the time. It's because they're not getting enough oxygen. That's why people, when you need to get stimulated, you stand up, even just the simplest of stretch. We're very much a flex society. Even at your desk, if you can just get up and stretch, it's so valuable. Get the oxygen going. So keep in mind that the food going in has a big impact on your body. Now, what food should we really eat? What I would like you to do, everybody here tonight, is have amnesia for the next 25, 30 minutes. Some of you have had that in the past, consciously or subconsciously. So just forget everything now. Forget who you are, where you came from. And we're going to do a little history class here. And you're going to try to find out where you fit in. All of a sudden, you've arrived on this planet. Where do you fit in? Well, what we want to understand is that there are 8,400,000 species on this planet. And you can say, well, I don't know about that, but that's a statistical fact, something that we don't have to research right now. Someone's already done it for us, 8,400,000. The interesting thing is that we are all divided up into 4 basic groups. And you're going to try to find out tonight where you fit in. And the 4 basic groups, number 1, we have the carnivore. Now, they happen to have an intestinal system 3 to 4 times the length of their body. We're basing it from hip to shoulder, 3 to 4 times the length of the body. Now, have you ever watched your dog eat or a dog eat? How's a dog eat? Gulps its food very, very quickly. It doesn't say, this is real good, you know, and munch it around. It just takes it in, and it's got a little short intestinal system, and it's in and out very quickly. Carnivore. Omnivore, omni meaning everything. They have an intestinal system 7 to 8 times the length of the body. The 3rd category, we have the herbivore, plant eaters. They have an intestinal system 10 to 12 times the length of the body, getting longer and longer. And final category is the frugivore, fruit eating. They have an intestinal system 12 to 14 times the length of the body. Now, if we could all cut ourselves open tonight, cut up, take a tape measure out, we would all find that magically everyone in this room has an intestinal system 12 times the length of the body. We had an incredible creator. He didn't mess up on anybody. We all have an intestinal system 12 times the length of the body. That means that we are halfway in between a herbivore, plant-eating, and fruit-eating entity. If we violate that, we have some problems that occur. For example, well, let me go back before I give you the example. There are a couple of other things that you might want to do on the checklist to see kind of where you fit in. The carnivore and the omnivore, they sweat through their tongue. And the herbivore and frugivore, they sweat through their skin. So do we have anyone here sweating through their tongue tonight? I hope not. I hope not. We got, all right. Now, if we also went in, there's something called hydrochloric acid, which is very important for digestion of food. They have 20 times as much as we do down here. So 1 part to 20. So that's why a dog can eat this tough fibrous tissue, take it in, and the hydrochloric acid will break it down. Also, the other final category on your checklist is these people here can only go up and down with their tooth structure. These people can go sideways and up and down. Grinding and up and down. So those are your 4 basic criteria, and you kind of figure out where you fit in. Now, let's say you are in this category, which everything points towards it. You're in the herbivore, frugivore category. What happens if you eat a piece of meat? All right, let's go through what really takes place in these bodies. And remember now, you're still in amnesia. You have no attachment to any types of food. You're just trying to figure out what would be best for you to eat. Well, what we've got to look at is that if we take in a piece of meat, it's going to take, and it's meat, fish, eggs, poultry, any of those things, it's going to take approximately 5 days to get through our system on the average. Now, A lot of people today say, I don't eat red meat anymore. You know, we got a lot that everywhere I go, I talk to people who say, I've given up red meat, but I eat chicken and fish. We've become very much a chicken society, fish society. What I'd like to talk about just right now, something like fish, which we all can relate to. What happens if we leave fish out in the sunshine? If we put it out today, what's the temperature, 85, something like that today? If we put the fish out there in the 85-degree temperature at 10 o'clock in the morning, and we went to pick it up at 4 o'clock, what's going to happen to that? At an 85-degree temperature, some of you starting to get the picture here now, what's the body temperature? 98.6. Something in your system, like fish, for 5 days at 98.6, you got a problem. It's going to definitely deteriorate rapidly. That's fish, which if you don't eat it right away, you got a big problem on your hands anyway. I mean, fish was the number one food killer in the country last year. 1,200 people died, but it doesn't mean anything compared to car accidents and cancer and heart disease. But still, 1,200 people died, all within 4 hours, very fast. So one of the things we have to realize is that the fish, it has no label on it. None of the foods have any label. The chocolate bar has 1,000 little labels on it, has all the chemicals in it, but the fish doesn't have anything. And part of the problem is here, you don't know whether or not it's poisonous. It isn't labeled that way. It doesn't tell you. For example, down in St. John, the U.S. Virgin Islands, I go down to Keneal each year, and there is one side of the island that the fish is very poisonous, and the other side it's perfectly okay. And if you eat this fish, you're going to have severe food poisoning very quickly. Now, when that fish comes to your plate, it doesn't say, hi, I'm from the west side. You know? And a lot of times the fish gets caught over. We're now messing up our ecology badly enough that what is happening is, and the waters are becoming, we have to go further and further out to fish, that there is an overflow getting on a certain side of the island. And you know what they do in the islands? You know how they test to see whether or not fish is poisonous? They lay the fish out. This is done in many countries around the world. They'll put fish out side by side, and the ones that the flies don't go on, that's the poisonous. Even the flies won't touch it. But we don't know that when it comes to our plate, and we do have a lot of problems. Every single city, every day, has some form of fish poisoning. Let's go back, however, to the meat aspect of it, because I think this is something that a lot of you have started to understand. Not only does it take a long time for us to get it in, but we've got to look at how do we get the piece of meat to our plate so we can eat it. Well, when an animal dies, rigor mortis sets in. The animal becomes very stiff. If you've ever seen an animal on the side of the road that's been hit by a car and has died, that animal is stiff quickly. Now, have you ever given any thought how that stiff animal gets to your plate in such a wonderful, tender form? Now, we got quite an array of people in the travel business here today. And we're all talking about marketing. And we all want ideas on how to market. If you really want to do something, I'd go out and hire the guy, if he's still alive, who worked for the meat industry and got us to really believe that that's what we should eat, because this is the most incredible marketing job done in the history of mankind. Because that animal, they call it, they give incredible terms. They call it hanging. We hang the animal. We cure it. We age it. We process it. They give you all kinds of terms, and the public buys it. What really happens? It rots. That's the way you get the food into your system. Once a rigor mortis sets in, the animal now must rot. And as it rots, some things occur. It discolors. Do you really believe that's red beef when you go walk along the counter? That's chemical dye number 13. We love the color red, so we're very attracted to it. But that animal rots, it discolors, it smells, and in go more and more chemicals. And our governmental system has become so liberal that in an average piece of meat here, they allow 2,000 chemicals that will go in a piece of meat, 38 of which are highly poisonous. And if you don't think they're highly poisonous, if you read in Chicago a couple of years ago where they had a little overdose of sodium nitrate, which had no label on it, by the way, that there was even sodium nitrate in it, 8 people died very quickly from food poisoning. So we've got to take a look at all these chemicals that are going in, what's also inherent in meat, and sometimes people don't want to hear this, but we're dealing, because you don't know anything about it, you got amnesia still. What is in a piece of meat? Every piece of flesh that exists anywhere, you have maggots and worms. Now, sure, you can cook them out. There's no question you can cook them out, but we'll talk about that when we show you the slides. There's a problem. And most important of all, we have adrenaline. Now, this is a highly toxic substance. That's why people actually die from, they can poison themselves to death. And I always remember I moved into a condo in Honolulu, and there was someone trying to get in my door, and they had knocked down the first chain. They'd opened the door, knocked down the first chain, and I walked out and I panicked, seeing this guy chopping down the chain. He got one more chain to go. Great safe America is over there. We've deadbolted ourselves in, but he's knocking down. I think the last chain's going to go, so I split into the bedroom. And I pick up the chest of drawers and I put it in front of the door. A little while later, the police finally came. I called my neighbors next door and I couldn't move the chest of drawers. And I'm sure all of you have appreciated that, what we can really do with adrenaline. Well, adrenaline is a highly, highly toxic substance, which we have nothing in our body to break it down. And one of the things, when I talk about stress, if you know, when I went to the first symposium with a group of doctors who convinced me to change and alter my diet and whatever, they said, if you're not putting this stuff in your system, you can't believe the tranquility that takes place, the internal harmony, because you're not fighting constantly to get all this stuff out. People wonder why they're tired. They're tired because they're putting in loads of foreign chemicals. They got all these things in here, which if you don't kill these guys, you got a problem. And I was a while ago out in Kailua, there's a fellow who does a colonic treatment where I think many of you have probably starting to get familiar with this, where they can actually reshape your colon. We'll show you what a colon shouldn't look like and should look like on the slides. But there's a theory out in medicine now that the health of your body is the health of your colon. Now, one of the problems here is there was a lady who was in before having a colonic treatment, and she had a very severe back problem. And they had it diagnosed as arthritis, bad hip, bad construction from God. They had a theory that she was just gotten old. I mean, she was only 45, but they said that's part of age. They gave her all kinds of theories, and she really couldn't walk very well. She went and she had a colonic treatment. They took a 3-foot worm out of her, which had wound around the spinal cord. Now, these guys, everybody starts out small. We got our baby pictures, and they all grow up. And these guys, if you don't kill them early, you got a problem. How do you kill them early? You cook them. Problem is, when you cook something, charcoal broiled steak, that's equivalent to smoking 3,000 cigarettes in the production of benzopyrene and methylcholinthrine. People say, oh, I don't smoke, but they take in equivalent, what's 30, how many packs a day is that? That's packs, 20 in a pack, that's 150 packs you take in one charcoal broiled steak. That's a lot of cigarettes. In the production of benzopyrene and methylcholinthrine, which are your top two cancer stimulating agents. So now all of this stuff goes in your system. What do we do? How do we get it out? Our body gets worn down bit by bit by having to take it out. So it's just not the food you eat in terms of nutritional or non-nutritional value. It's the stuff you put in it. And then we got all these preservatives. What are preservatives for anyway? They preserve stuff a long time. You preserve that stuff in your system. Anything left in your body. I don't care if you leave cabbage in your body for 5 days. It's going to stink in there. You got a problem. The idea when you eat, our bodies were constructed. We eat the right foods that go in. We get the maximum nutritional benefit from it, and we get them out of there very quickly. If we don't, we're going to have disease. Most of those guys that were on the slide, they had a slit in their stomach right down here from getting cut open. And it all starts in the colonic area. So what we want to do now is kind of take a little trip through the various slides that we have to give you an idea of kind of the different perspective of exercise, nutrition, see the importance of it. This is the article that came out in March of 84 that truly changed the understanding of nutrition. Cholesterol and now the bad news. Before this article came out, there was an interesting study that was done, and they asked the American layperson, and they said, do you believe that cholesterol will have an effect on heart disease or heart attacks? 69% of the population said yes. 31% of the doctors said yes. The doctors are really afraid to come out and speak. With the malpractice suits now, they're really afraid to say something. But most important of all, only 17 of our 121 medical schools in America have a course in nutrition. One course. So if we want to know about nutrition, we can't really count on most doctors. I really think our society should be just like the Chinese society. The doctors are paid at the end of the month if you stayed healthy. Wouldn't that be nice? What happens today? You're sick in bed. You call up the nurse, and what's the nurse say? Come on down to the office. Can't move. Not only have we lost the service industry today, but doctors have lost the essence of what they're really supposed to be doing. They should be educating us. What have dentists done? They have concentrated on preventive medicine. Doctors are going to have to change, whether they like it or not, to the concept of preventive medicine. What we're really talking about here tonight, we're not talking cure. I don't have any magical cure. Doctors don't have any magical cure. A lot of doctors will even admit that it's luck. I remember my father a little while ago was going in for an operation, and they didn't know what was wrong with him. And I'm sitting in the hospital, and I'm trying to get some stuff out of this doctor, and I say, well, you mean you have no idea? He says, no. When we doctors don't know something, we go in, cut them up, go in and take a look and see what the problem is. That's a bad way for us to be thinking. We got to start thinking a little bit more about how can we deal preventively. And if we take a look at these two substances, you now know what this is. You now can really look at a piece of bacon for the rest of your life and know how it got there, why it looks the color it is, and what the real smell of it is. It's just been covered up. You know that. What about these guys? Everybody says eggs. Well, there are two people who should give up eggs immediately. Women and athletes. So if we have a female athlete in here, you got double reason to give it up. Eggs are an unbelievable glue. If you ever take a look at the paint that's on the front of an aircraft, a good portion of that paint is made from eggs. It's a fantastic adhesive. When you go to cook, you put all the flour on top of the counter, and magically throw an egg in and it sticks all together. It also sticks to your arterial wall. And one of the reasons women should be very careful about not eating eggs is women, they have very fine skin tissue in around the eyes. And so women will tend to wrinkle here sooner. So what actually happens is you have your main arterial wall, and then you have a lot of little capillaries leading off it. And the main arterial wall, as it becomes clogged from the atherosclerotic buildup, it closes off the little capillaries, which ultimately shuts down the nutrient flow to the skin area. And that's why I'm fascinated when I speak at the World Vegetarian Congresses, and I'll see women 55, 60 years of age who've been lifetime vegetarians, and they don't have any wrinkles on their face. Well, one of the things here, that this is a great way not only to wrinkle up your body, it actually dries it up because it's such a wonderful adhesive, but women have a problem with varicose veins. Where do women put weight on first? Right in the center area. Women have lower center of gravity, and when they have a child, they've got an even greater weight center in here, which causes them to force the pressure up in their valve system in their legs. Just like a hose. You squeeze a hose, what happens? Pressure builds up. Same thing. So eggs, they also constipate your blood vessels. They really cause a lot of problems. They're not a healthy food to eat, contrary to what the statistics are out. There was a big article, the papers recently, that eggs don't raise your cholesterol count. Let me tell you who did the study. First of all, it was funded fully by the egg industry. Secondly, you know what they did? They took 12 guys who had a cholesterol count of 310. Now, that's really high. It's hard to get up above that. And they fed them 10 eggs a day for 2 weeks, so they said the cholesterol count didn't go up. It's all to do with the population study. If they took someone that had a cholesterol count of, say, 160, their cholesterol count at the end of that period would probably be all the way up to 240 or 250, maybe even higher. So you got to, when you read a study in a newspaper, find out who did it first. That's never in the release. One of the things you really want to try to do as you're going through the evening, You want to kind of look and see from a common sense point of view. As I said earlier, I'm not telling you to eat this food or not to eat. But next time you take a look at an egg, there is some nutritional value. But compared to all of the other factors, it's not such a good food to put in, particularly as we look more now at the cholesterol aspect. This is what your vessel should look like. You should have a clean flow through. This should be our target. This is what most people's look like. Your blood is always clotting. It's always coagulating. If it didn't coagulate, we'd have a big problem. When we cut ourselves, we'd bleed to death. And there are some people who don't have that capability, so every time they cut themselves, they've got a very severe problem on their hands. This is how heart attacks occur, right in here. Let's take a look now at, we'll get to the heart attack shortly, but I want to show you what the inner lining of your vessel should look like if you're eating well. There's a little bit of cholesterol, atherosclerotic buildup in here. You can just see it minimally. And then a little larger here, pretty much the same. And this is what most people, by the time they get to be age 26 in America today, this is an average vessel. And this is someone who didn't make it. This is taken from someone who had such a severe atherosclerotic buildup. And if you can go back to the first slide, if you took it and closed it over, they would have very little area. And let's take a look now at what cholesterol looks like coming down. Anytime you eat foods with cholesterol, it's coming down. And it's looking for places to hook onto. Now, the body has an ability to get rid of 100 milligrams a day. I don't want to get into milligrams and all that stuff too much, but you should remember this statistic. The body can get rid of 100 milligrams per day. The average American diet takes in 500 milligrams. So we're banking 400 milligrams every single day. Heart attack, here it is. This is an enlarged cross-section of a heart attack. This is the blood, it clotted. And it can't get through the smallest hole. That's called the end of your life. As soon as the largest clot equals the smallest hole, it's all over. And it can, people say, oh, he looked so healthy. They didn't look inside. That's very important. On the outside, we can fool a lot of people. Our triple cheeseburger. This triple cheeseburger has 12 tablespoons of fat in it. It's a pretty good amount. That's a quote from the American Science Digest that just came out about 3 months ago. But I always look at this, and I think, how our consciousness changes. We see things differently as we get older, sometimes for the worse, sometimes for the better, hopefully for the better. But, I've been in a car driving along someplace, and there'll be a car accident. And there will be someone lying on the road, cut. And everybody in the car, oh, and then they cover their eyes. They don't look. Mothers turn their children away, don't look. And they're horrified by that sight. Yet they will take a ground-up animal, put it in between two buns and their mouth waters. It's amazing how our consciousness has changed to that point. And let me tell you, for those of you who've ever been to a slaughterhouse, if you want to see where this comes from, it's tough to get into a slaughterhouse now because they're getting such bad publicity. But if you can ever get in there, find out how that comes about. And I doubt that you'll eat another hot dog or hamburger again or sausage. I'll have to read this. I want to get this blown up. This is such a good cartoon. It says, stay away from them. These are lions and the men walking through the jungle. Stay away from them. They're very dangerous, loaded with cholesterol. If the animal world could talk, we really aren't such juicy morsels as we used to be. All right, this is what we talked a little earlier about the colon. Let's do a little quick physiological review. Food goes in your mouth, goes down the esophagus, goes into your stomach, goes into the small intestine where the nutrients are taken out, and then the waste products, the stuff that you couldn't use, goes in here. Now, many people have stuff that's in here for up to 15 years because they don't have an efficient flow. And let me show you what most people's colons look like. And I'm not suggesting that you go out and get another x-ray, but if you really find that you've got a lot of stomach problems, whether you've got a lot of gas or you feel certain pains down in this area, maybe you want to take a look at this. Get you an x-ray. We had a tennis professional in our company who his... this is what we matched it up to be. Looked very much like this. He also had very severe back problems. So what happens here is, look at these small areas that you can see. No wonder food has problems going through them. Now it is possible, let's go back again, to reverse this. This is your ascending colon, transverse, descending, and then the food leaves your body. It is possible to reshape your colon. And most people, really and truly, are very similar to this. They'll have some sort of deformed colon area. And that really is something that we want to take a look at. There's some wonderful theories, and I'm saying theories now, wonderful theories about the health of your body is related to the health of your colon. And you may want to have a colonic treatment. I think we're going to see the end of this era, the rich foods. But I'd like to just share something with you. Look at this gentleman's eyes. You tell the health of your body according to what your eyes look like. What's amazing today is, you know, parents, I'll talk to them and say, my kid's on drugs. I had no idea they're on drugs. I don't know what you're looking at. But all you have to do is look at a person's eyes. If they drink, if they smoke, if they do drugs, if they eat the wrong foods, all toxins end up in here. Most of you know that most of the nerves end in your eyes. Remember the phrase, the eyes are the mirror of your soul. Look at this gentleman. Do you have to look? Look up here. Do you have to look at the rest of him? No, you don't. He's got his tongue out. He's looking at all these greasy foods. We tend to live our life based on 3 inches. That's about the length of most people's lives. The tip of the tongue to the last taste bud. That's all it is. That's the only reason people do most things. Because at the end of 3 inches, it's over. You have no more gratification. It's finished. So if people can learn to control those 3 inches, they can really do a lot with their life. Melt 20 pounds off your tummy, hips, and thighs. Melt fat? Fat boils at 360 degrees. I mean, it's unbelievable that we get away with this stuff. You should never diet, ever. There never has been, never will be a diet that works. Let's talk about diet for a sec. What happens when you diet? Let's say you lose 20 pounds on a diet. That'll be 10 pounds fat, 5 pounds muscle, and 5 pounds water. That's basically what the 20 pounds is. What do most people do when they diet? They get it off, and then they go right back to eating. You should never attempt to do it that way because you lose muscle and you start taking on a frumpier look. I had a fellow in Chicago last year who came up and he'd lost 2,000 pounds over the last 5 years. He up and down and up and down. The way you lose weight is through exercise, not through dieting. Yes, lower your caloric intake. Understand foods. You like milkshakes? Most people like milkshakes. They're 500 calories. It's a lot of calories. So if you're going to have a milkshake one day, figure out what you can't have the next day if you have a weight problem. And women have a problem. Women have to eat 25% less than their male counterpart to stay even. It's not fair, but that's the way it is. So the whole point here is do not be hooked into this stuff. It does not work. When you diet, your body says, uh-oh, emergency, and it starts laying down more fat. So when you diet, you actually get fatter. Can't change a bad habit by just scratching the surface. They've got this thing, liposuction now, where they go in, they cut open a section of your stomach, and they suck out the fat. Very popular. The doctors are advertising it like crazy. But let me tell you something. They don't just suck fat out. They also are taking nerves out. People are finding now severe back problems, severe gastrointestinal problems because of this. It will never be perfected. Do not get hooked into this stuff. Plus, a lot of them don't leave such a good scar. You know what I think we should do? I really believe that we should be given at our peak shape a skirt size, a pant size, a shirt size that we have to stick with for the rest of our life. Can you imagine what a great motivator that would be? That if you had a shirt like this, that was your size when you were young, and all of a sudden this started, people come up, hey, what's this? You know, they start poking in there. That would be just such a motivator to get it off. But what do? Look at the stores. The stores, you go down, they just get, particularly here in Hawaii, we have the muumuus, where the people just drape them over them, and they look the same. You can't tell if the person weighs 150 or 300 pounds. So we really, you know, set your target. When I got overweight, I set my target. I'm going back to 32 inches. That's what I was when I was younger. And I met that in 5.5 weeks. I lost 25 pounds in 5.5 weeks doing an aerobic activity. And I wasn't fat. I was just got some extra stuff on my stomach there. And fortunately, I had enough people who went around and grabbed it. And that's what we need. We shouldn't be tolerant of that. Bicycling. Talked about the stationary bicycle. Excellent exercise. Wonderful. Provided what? You work with your heart rate at a certain level for a certain period of time, not anaerobically, being able to carry on a normal conversation. You still should be able to yell at the kids from the bicycle. All of these are or can be. Might not be able to see this. This is the running using the heavy hands, stationary bicycle up here. If you do exercises on the Nautilus equipment, it can be an aerobic activity, provided you go from exercise to exercise and you keep your heart rate up. When I did I wrote a book called Aerobic Workout Book for Men, and I did it. More people, women said, "Why did you just do it for the men?" I said, "Well, you ever taken a look at the out of shape male population? Many women have been very conscientious about getting themselves in shape." But I went to a lot of women's programs, and the women, they'd work real hard, and then for 6 or 7 minutes, then they'd stop and they'd do a little jog and a little stretch, and then they'd work hard again. They might as well stayed in bed. They wondered why they weren't getting the maximum benefit. Aerobic activity, the key to it is it must be continuous. So as long as you can keep it a continuous, you'll be okay. This activity does not mean that you're going to get in shape. This is good. It's good for muscle tone. It's good for certain isolated exercises. But I can't tell you how many people think they're getting in shape because they do this. The two biggest offenders of not getting in shape are weightlifters and golfers. Guy says, "Oh, I golfed on Saturday and Sunday this week," and he thought he had exercise. Well, you can probably took a swing, get sit in his car, and drive a little, move along. Then he gets out and he moves again. I mean, there's no exercise. Even when you used to have pre-cart days, still wasn't much of an activity. Why? Because your heart rate wasn't up there. I'm not suggesting that next time you go on an airplane, you get suited up and jog up and down the aisles, but you got to exercise while you're traveling. Get up, move. You should not sit for more than a couple of hours at a time, maximum. Do your exercise, go to the back, stretch. There's all kinds of good stretching activities that you can do. Get the blood flowing. Blood will tend to pool, particularly in the lower part of your body, as you found on a long flight trying to put your shoes on. Not that easy sometimes. Here it is. Photos wherever you go. You have these options all the time. I'm amazed. Even, you know, a lot of these buildings, I know they have fire escape problems and everything. You can't get up and down the stairs. But people, they get on at the lobby and they get off at the second floor. It's amazing. We have all these opportunities during the course of our day to physically exercise. Interesting enough, in Japan, now look what we're seeing here. Same thing. Meetings are now incorporating this. You should try to, those of you that are in charge of meeting planning programs and whatever, this is essential. There's absolutely no question that the meeting will be that much more productive. We take a look. This was shot over in Taiwan recently. This is what meat should look like. This is the reality of it. It's brown, often gray. People who work in restaurants know that. But this is what we make it look red. Have you ever had a nosebleed? You seen the blood? It dries up. It becomes different color very shortly thereafter. It is not. You are not drinking the blood of the animal when you have that. Do not be fooled into it. Here's a good statement. A defense against cancer can be cooked up in your kitchen. One of the things I found as I traveled to the different societies around the world, those that had more of a vegetarian-based diet, who ate fruits, grains, and vegetables, cancer, leukemia, atherosclerotic buildup, it just didn't exist. They were non-existent disease. Osteoporosis is non-existent in vegetarian communities around the world, in vegetarian societies. There it is. This is your 3,000 cigarettes that we talked about. Cancer epidemic in fish. How are we getting cancer in fish? This is a Newsweek article that appeared recently. How can that possibly happen? You know what we're doing? Trying to make money and trying to save. What we're doing is when they have a cow that comes to the slaughterhouse, never was a good artist, so here's your, they got the cow coming to the slaughterhouse. If a cow's got cancer at the hind end, they will cut it out. And guess where they're sending it to? The fish hatcheries. And suddenly now, we've got a cancer epidemic in fish. How? Even this is ridiculous. When you cut it out, When you cut it out the rear end, where's cancer? It's in the bloodstream. It's throughout. Those of you who saw, anyone see 60 Minutes that on the chicken? I mean, that's it. If you didn't see it, find someone who taped it. Fabulous show. There is no chicken today. I mean, they said something like 98% or whatever, but all chicken has leukosis in it, which is chicken cancer. The great, what they didn't say about chicken and talk enough about was the growth hormones. If you saw the Time magazine article on growth hormones, with in Puerto Rico, they took 2,200 kids that they finished up with at the end of the study. And they found that those kids that had been raised predominantly on a chicken diet, that the kids, the young girls, were starting their menstrual cycle at age 5, and the boys had their hair was starting to fall out at age 11 and 12. What do you do now? You take a chicken that is produced, used to be produced in 2 years, they produce it in 5 weeks. How do they do that? Magic. Growth hormones. And I've never found a guy who's excited when his hair starts falling out. And if you want to get older sooner, you eat these foods that have a tremendous number of growth hormones. If that's your goal and you're excited about it, then you do it. Yeah, I saw this in Taiwan. This is not so clear, but this is the chicken. They were here, and next thing, just shortly thereafter, they were on top, and I had no idea. I just thought, wow, for what? And I used to eat chicken lots of times, but it had a very profound effect on me when I saw it. Here's our buddy Frank Perdue. He's a friend of mine. He tells me now, this used to take 6 weeks. He now is magically producing it in 5 weeks. You talk about stress. You know, you think you got stress. Look what these chickens and chicken, little chickies, and look what they go through. This is 5 weeks later. Magic formulas. They're all of them are de-beaked. These guys, they live their life in an area the size of a typing paper. And we take on a very, very stressed entity when we put them into our system. Rabbis at kosher poultry farm put emphasis on nice killing. You know, where's our society going? Whoever defined nice killing? You know, it just amazes me when I see the advertising that's being done out there to try to get us to think another way. The slaughterhouses. I grew up as a hockey player. I got drafted by St. Louis Blues in the National Hockey League. And those of you that are familiar with the hockey world, it's a very violent world. When I was a young child, I was trained that when I got into a fight, that if I didn't knock the guy's teeth out or break his nose, I had a lousy fight. That's what I was trained on. And so I grew up in a fairly hardened environment. But let me tell you something. When I walked into a slaughterhouse and I saw a baby lamb 5 feet away from me, a living creature, and have a spike put through its head and took its life out, I walked out of there and I said, I'll starve to death before I'll support that again. And it had a very, very sound effect on me. We tend not to sort of take a look back and see exactly what we're doing. We talk about stress. Look at this. There's no difference. People are running around and with all this frenetic energy, and they don't take time to really think a lot. We have grown up very stressed out. I used to love this, you know. I saw a guy a while ago. I was up in Canada. He was practicing his fishing pole in the hardware store, and I had immediate flashback to fishing days. But how do you catch fish? You cheat them. Thin filament net, lure, worm on the end of a hook. And for what? And we hold up, we say, look what I did. I cheated this fish. Aren't I good? All the people that want to have their picture taken thinking they've accomplished something. When did we really? And for once again, for what benefit? Sport. I really have a hard time with that. Going out and gunning some innocent creature down and saying, hey, this is a wonderful sport out. This is on the front of a sporting magazine. And here's another sport. It's called Harlem. It's the same thing. Got two guys taking care of another individual. All violent. We never stop some time to think about it. If you think you're a carnivore, you should be able to do this. Tonight, if I brought a cow in here and said, welcome, folks, for our dinner tonight, we're going to have a cow, and you're all allowed to take a hunk out of it. None of you could take a hunk out. These teeth are not meant for ripping and tearing flesh. We don't have that capability. These guys do. There's carnivore's teeth. Now, these pictures here, and a good study was done recently for people who are emotionally disturbed or young children. And young children were asked a very important question. They had a series of questions they were to answer, but it said, what world are you closest to? And it came down between the adult world and the animal world. And almost every kid said, I'm closest to the animal world. It's very interesting. And so these little series of photos here, you know, and as I travel around the world, in some of the countries I go to, they eat dogs. And people are shocked at it. And that's why it's also very interesting when people come over here from India for the first time, who've come out of, say, the villages or some of the smaller towns, and even prior to the English rule over there, they were shocked when we ate cows. It's all depend on society. It's like in China, you know, they have on some of the menus there, those of you seen fried cockroaches. I mean, we're shocked by that, but they see it as a delicacy. You know, these kinds of photos of living creatures, you know, there's a moral side to eating too. There's a physiological side, which we've talked about. It'll make you healthier. But all living entities, you know, there's a wonderful world out there that sometimes we don't look at. You know, all living entities have their young ones. And the baby seals, I'm sure a lot of you have spoken out or maybe support Greenpeace or some of the causes against the slaughter of the baby seals. And here's my favorite photo. You know, next time you think about your rabbit stew, maybe you can relate to the photo. I'm not suggesting you go out and you pick up your friendly orangutan and become buddies with them, but, you know, there is something to be said a little bit above and beyond. Sometimes, you know, people say, a little bit of meat doesn't hurt us. And that's a fact. A little bit piece of meat ain't going to hurt you. But that's a very selfish approach we take a look at. You know, a little piece of meat doesn't come from a still live animal. We don't just take a hunk out of the animal and still let it go. So there's a different perspective. People switch their eating habits physiologically, morally, or ecologically. The world food hunger. If this room were a piece of land, we could produce 22 times as much food in here if we grew it for fruits, grains, and vegetables as if we grew it for the production of animal slaughter. Smokers, or people who live in LA or Orange County now. This is a lung of someone who lives in Los Angeles. Not bad, but quite different from Wisconsin and areas where the air is not so polluted. And I'm not suggesting you have the mass exodus out of here very quickly, because you'll still live pretty well if you eat well and are not around smokers. A person who lives with a smoker, I'm in the process of getting this lung. A person who lives with a smoker or works with a smoker will be about, it'll turn gray, it'll be completely covered over. I just had a chance to see the slide that they got, and it's in the process of being made. So don't let anyone fool you. And those of you who are really anxious to see, they're so close now. I just talked to some people in Washington. We're so close to having no smoking on aircraft. If you just keep writing, they're about 5,000 letters short from what I understand. And we got, each of you know one friend who doesn't like smoking here, so maybe you can double that up and keep it going. This is a one-pack-a-day smoker. Here's a two-pack-a-day. And here's someone who had emphysema and never did make it. Emphysema is irreversible. Once you get it, you cannot go back. It's one of those few diseases that you can't. You can reverse cancer. You can reverse bad hearts. Those of you who saw Nathan Pritikin's report, his vessels were whistle clean. He had completely reversed any atherosclerotic buildup. And now, as far as cancer is concerned, Dr. Agatha Thrash out of Seal, Alabama, has only lost one patient in 15 years. She only takes patients in their last 30 days. She puts them on a raw fruits and vegetables diet. Her theory is that the body needs protein. We all know that. We don't have to have protein per se, but the body ultimately needs protein. And what happens is that it'll suck up the protein from the cancer cells, dry it up, and she's been able to cure it. Called a quack theory, but she's got thousands and thousands of people who are alive today from having had cancer. Smokers, they never tell you that you're going to wrinkle up your face. This fellow, by the way, had cancer. He went on a vegetarian diet. I just read an article on him recently. Quit smoking, no longer does the Marlboro ads, and has cured himself. But once again, smokers' faces, there it is, all dried up, all pucked, and it does a lot of damage in addition just to blackening your lungs. Our kids, we now have found that 9 out of 10 kids in America can't do one pull-up. Isn't that unbelievable? They can't get themselves up one time. George Allen said that We now have 90% of our kids can't pass a basic physical fitness test, not just one pull-up. George Allen being head of the President's Council on Physical Fitness. America's nutrition revolution, it's underway. It should have been underway a long time ago, but at least it started. Food intake. Everybody talks about protein. And I know some of you, if you were thinking of questions to ask, you were going to say, what about protein? Well, let me just, that's a complete myth. Your body doesn't need protein per se. What it needs are amino acids. So let's take an amino acid like lysine, L-Y-S-I-N-E. Lysine is in chicken and it's in broccoli. If you take lysine in either of those, the body doesn't know any different. So take it in broccoli rather than take it in chicken, which is going to have all of the negative problems that will occur. But most important of all, let's talk now about protein. Those of you who are working on your marketing programs for your agencies and travel programs, well, once again, the meat industry and the dairy industry and egg industry did a tremendous job in getting us to think about protein. We've become obsessed with protein. In 1965, the charts said 50% of our diet should be protein. The revised charts in 1975, 30%. In 1985, the recommended was 10%. And you know what the World Health Organization says? 5% of our food intake should be protein to live a healthy life. So things are changing. We don't want protein. When you take in protein, excess protein in our body, those people who drink goat's milk and rice, that's sufficient protein. They're the strongest people per body weight. You don't need a lot. When you take in extra protein, your body can't get rid of it very easily. And what it usually does is what it can't get rid of, it stores as fat. So that's why people eat a lot of protein. They get fatter. Pasta. This is the food that you should be, carbohydrates are what you should be basing your food intake on. Most charts now are recommending 75 to 80% of your food intake should be pasta. What was once known as the poor man's food, the potatoes, rice, grains, is now becoming known as the rich person's food, rich in terms of intelligence. They now know that this is the best food you can eat. This is not fattening. The potato is not fattening. What you put on it is fattening. This potato, which is about a 3.5 ounce potato, it only has 93 calories as is. Turn it into French fries, becomes 273 calories. Turn it into potato chips and it becomes 602 calories. So if you have some stock in Frito-Lay, I apologize. And if you happen to like potato chips, be aware of that. Know that when you have a bag of potato chips, that's a lot of calories. So something has to go during that day. I'm not saying take away all of these nice foods that you enjoy, milkshakes and whatever. Just be a little bit more careful. Stir-fried vegetables. Fortunately now, most of our society today is aware that this is where we want to go. We want to have a lot of stir-fried vegetables as opposed to the boiled vegetables where we used to pour down all the nutrients in the drain. All vegetarian, all soy products. I know some of you looked at that and salivary glands started going. Well, many foods out today, and some of you have had soy foods. Some are good, some aren't so good. But the important thing is that if you cook it right, you can make most foods taste like it. You can take a fruit like breadfruit and make it taste just like Kentucky Fried Chicken. Can't tell any difference. You can now take, there are many restaurants around. I got a great article done in Business Traveler, the Asian publication, and it listed all the best vegetarian restaurants in Asia. Absolutely superb. You can go and you can have any food, which is mock fish, mock beef, mock turkey, whatever you want. So if you're attached to the taste, there's still a way of satisfying your taste, but eating the right kind of foods that aren't going to harm you. The meat industry here, this is an ad with James Garner, the meat industry is petrified. The interesting thing now that occurred in Orlando last year, the American Meat Board met for their convention, and the head of the American Meat Board got up and said, folks, please don't be surprised if by the year 2000 we're not in business. So what are they going to do? They got James Garner and Sybil Shepherd, who doesn't eat meat, but she's out there plugging away on it. And they got old Peggy Fleming. Peggy's peddling pork now. You know, I mean, now what a shame. You know, I look at this and I say, you know, as athletes, you know, I see these athletes who, they're getting into drug problems and everything. And having grown up in the athletic world, I thought, geez, you know, so many people look to us as leaders. And to think that, you know, here's a very great athlete out peddling something that as apps can do absolutely no good for your system. I mean, there is nothing in there that will enter into the plus column compared to the negative column that will be of any benefit to you all. Here's the big fish oils. Max EPE, they're all capitalizing. Please don't get fooled into this. What happens here is that when you take these fish oils, they will prevent some clotting. That's true. It's also why one of the big killers of Eskimos, they, you know what they die from? Is they die from nosebleeds because they eat so darn much fish that their blood is so thin that it doesn't have the ability to clot, and they just bleed themselves to death. Well, if you have a lot, this is an irrelevant question here. What people are doing, it's like in your kitchen sink. Let's say you got a lot of bacon fat, and you pour the bacon fat down the sink. What do you got to do next? You got to get under the sink or go to the store and buy some Drano. Well, instead of wasting all the money on the Drano, don't put the bacon fat down in the first place. Put it where it goes, should belong, in the garbage can. Same thing here. Don't put the bacon fat down your bloodstream so that you have to take this in order to balance it out, but there's a price to be paid. Those people who are taking these automatically will increase their chances for obesity, greasy skin, osteoporotic buildup. Why do we have osteoporosis in our societies? Well, because when you eat too much protein, how do you get protein out of your body comfortably? You got to take calcium. Calcium's the tracer. It's got to take the protein out. So out goes the calcium out of your bones, and we have lots more osteoporosis. Bob Barker, the Miss Universe or Miss America pageant or whatever it was, he would not go on until all furs were imitation. One of the things here is that if you've been to any of these farms and seen the suffering that these creatures go through, and for what? You know, to look more beautiful? The way you look more beautiful is to eat properly, not just get yourself all piled up. So people are moving more to imitation furs. They did a study recently in Spain. They found that 60% of the Spaniards wanted to total elimination of the bullfights. And I don't know if any of you have ever visited. When I went, I cheered like crazy for the bull. I was so excited when the bull was putting them up. I mean, I wasn't, you know, into any good food or any moral thing or anything. I just found myself cheering for the bull. And I thought, gee, that's unbelievable. You know, now I look back on it. What are we, for what? We call that a sport? People want to know about vitamins. I took this because those of you who read Fit for Life, there's some fabulous, one of the best books ever written. There's some things in there that are not so accurate. But basically, the book is a good, sound book. It took a lot of static from the doctors because they don't understand that stuff. So they had to speak out against it. It doesn't fit in with their lifestyle. They're trained for cure. So Fit for Life talked about the vitamins you needed. And I thought they said a great quote in there. The amount of vitamins you need fit into a thimble during the course of a year. Unless for females who have a low iron deficiency or other people who may have a chemical imbalance or something or vitamin deficiency, get a blood chemistry test. You should know certain things. You should know your cholesterol count. Just like you know your age, your social security number, your phone number, you should know your cholesterol count. If you don't know your cholesterol count, you're doing yourself a great disservice. There's a magic number, 150. There is no recorded heart attack in the history of the world so far that if you had 150 or lower, it's just never occurred. And that comes from, that's William Castelli, who's done that study since 1937, and they have done something like 347,000 people. So try to get your cholesterol count down. You get it down by proper diet. You don't lower your cholesterol count through exercise, by the way. That's a myth. You lower your cholesterol count through proper diet. Nathan Pritikin's son, who happens to be a vegetarian, found that on a vegetarian diet, you can lower your cholesterol count 25% in 3.5 weeks. Take a look at this for a second, what this could really mean. Statistically, most people in the room today probably have a cholesterol count, particularly the guys around 240. Lower that 1/4, that goes down 60, that would take you into a range of 180. Hardly anyone dies at 180. 150 to 180 is pretty darn safe. 150 is super safe. My cholesterol count now is 135. I'm not going to die of a heart attack. My plane may go down, I may die in a car crash, whatever. I'm not going to die of a heart attack. And you want to know something for the women out there? Be very careful that you work hard and get your husband to get this down. Here's a good statistic. 98% of the men who had a heart attack last year and lived knew it was coming long before. They had the pains. They felt the left arm. They felt it in there, but they're too macho to tell anybody. And that's unfortunate. 1 million people died last year from heart attacks. That's too high, much too high. No one should die of a heart attack. So check your cholesterol count. It's the barometer of your lifespan. You don't need to go. A lot of people spend money going to soothsayers, fortune tellers, and whatever. That's your true indicator. Now, there is another thing. I don't want to get into it too much tonight. If you have some questions, you should know what your high-density lipoprotein, low-density, I think you know, many of you have read that. Just remember what you want. High-density lipoprotein, HDL, call it highly desirable. HDL is your highly desirable. It's the one you want. The higher you can get that up, and the lower you can get your total cholesterol count down, the safer you're going to be. You don't want LDL. Cholesterol fighter, trend. They're capitalizing on it. We need cholesterol. Why do you want Quaker oats? There's two very good pluses. First of all, it's good fiber. We need, those of you who don't know about the purpose of fiber, well, it moves food through your system. Remember I showed you the colon? Well, anything that's stuck in there, the more fiber you can have, the sooner it will get it through your system. Also, and I'm always a little reluctant to talk about this, because people think, oh, you shouldn't say those things. I want to do the evaluation in the seminar, and I apologize for what I'm going to say, but it's very important, because there's been a book written on it, and some of you may have read it. But you measure also the health of your body by your bowel movements. And the doctor who wrote the famous book went to Africa, and he was out in the jungle, and he found 2-foot bowel movements. And he said, wow, my gosh, what are they eating? And there is, it's been proven now medically, that the longer your bowel movement, the healthier you are. And something like Quaker oats, which has a lot of fiber, not only will move system through, but it's also a binder, so that it will suck up any sort of bacteria that's stuck in there, and it will carry it along with it. You know, when I went to the symposium with a group of doctors in Hawaii, and they talked to me about the importance of a vegetarian diet, they said that you have an antibody system, which is a phenomenal system, okay, large cross-section of your bloodstream. You've got little antibodies that are in there. We have such a wonderful antibody system. Look what we've put in our system already, and we're still sitting here tonight. So the food goes in, it's collected, and it's taken away. They made a statement, as a vegetarian, your chances of getting sick are very minimal. And the reason behind it is, let's say that tonight, one of you came in here with a very bad cold, and all of a sudden you're breathing out this air, and you're putting all these viruses into the system of someone else. As a vegetarian who's got a very clean system, because you're not putting the chemicals, all of the other adrenaline flow, all those foreign entities into your system, the toxins, therefore your system will be able to clean that up very quickly. And that's one thing I have noticed. I mean, being on the air, being up in the air, traveling 300 days a year for 20 straight years, I mean, I just get sick so rarely. And when I was eating meat, I got sick all the time, because there's tremendous force. I mean, the air is polluted up in the air. You now, in an aircraft, then automatically, just the weird time schedules that we end up leading when we're in a business on the road, being able to keep that system clean is unbelievable. And sleeping time, I used to sleep 10 hours a day. I was able to cut it to 4 or 5 hours a day and feel good about getting up. 10 hours a day, I mean, I could barely get up because my body was so worn out. It takes 33% of your energy to digest your food as a vegetarian. It's about 65% as a meat eater. So all of that extra energy is digested. You wonder, oh boy, I feel really sluggish today. Well, the reason you feel sluggish is because you ate the wrong foods. You want energy? Eat carbohydrates. Pasta meal is a wonderful food. So, yes, tonight, just here, just living in Los Angeles, you breathe all kinds of stuff in there that doesn't belong. So the idea is, the more polluted a city, the tougher your schedule, the more conscientious you have to be about taking in food. If you really want a simple approach, try to have a salad a day, or every 2 days. Try to have a fruit a day, and try to concentrate your base on carbohydrates, which is your pastas, grains, potatoes, things like that. You will have more than enough nutrients. You won't have to worry anymore. For example, when you eat a cow, where did the cow get all its nutrients? Got it from the grains. When you take a piece of grain, let's say this was a piece of grain, came out of Kansas. This is 15% quality protein. You take it and put it in the form of animal, comes out as 2% quality protein. You lose 750% quality. So the whole idea is, same thing with vitamins, You know, they've got to extract a whole lot more vitamins to actually get this concentrated form, when really most people have a very balanced bloodstream anyway. Get your blood count. Take a look at it. Make sure. Have a blood chemistry test done. All it is, if you have trouble with needles, they'll turn the other way, stick the needle in, get your blood, and you'll be fine. You've got to have it. For men over 35, you've got to have it. It's real important. Women don't have to worry so much about their blood count until after menopause, because then it really happens. If you watch the heart attack charts, women will go along fairly steadily, and then all of a sudden menopause comes, and it climbs so steadily, whereas men tend to climb fairly regularly. With that little dip around 35, they'll come down a little bit at 35, and then they'll go back up. There are three types of vegetarians. There's a lacto-ovo, L-A-C-T-O, ovo, O-V-O, which is dairy products and eggs. Very few vegetarians eat eggs. If they do, they're non-fertilized. The majority of vegetarians are lacto-vegetarians, which are dairy products. That's what I am. Or a vegan, V-E-G-A-N, and they do not have any dairy products. Now, all I can say right now is that the studies that are coming out, those that are vegans have a rapid loss or depletion of brain cells on the right side of your brain, which is your creative side. However, we don't have enough of a population study to know. There are, when I did the book Vegetarian Primer, what I tried to do was I tried to research all of the reasons for drinking milk and for not drinking milk. Scripturally, it's very interesting. When I went back and took a look at the Quran, the Bible, the Upanishads, the Rishas, the Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, whatever, they all talked about the importance of food intake for milk to be able to contemplate spiritual ideas. So since we all are spiritual beings, therefore I think we're going to see some very interesting studies coming out on whether or not to take in too much milk. There is now known, we really abort milk. I mean, the way we do it is unbelievable. But if you can get milk in a somewhat unaborted manner, if that's possible, I feel that it's the most practical, logical diet. I mean, people love cheese in today's society. I mean, it'd be very difficult for people to give up cheese. If you have a severe problem, if you have some cancer, or if you have some severe arthritic problems, I would recommend get off all dairy products immediately and then maybe go back on a little bit. I love ice cream. I just stay away from Häagen-Dazs because it's got so many eggs in it. I mean, just shoot your cholesterol count up. But there are a lot of very natural ice creams out there that you can have that don't have eggs in them. But once again, the studies that have been done. Remember people talked about how bad sugar was? They never did a darn study on vegetarians. They did it all on meat eaters. A meat eater who takes in sugar, they got a big problem because there's so much sugar in all the foods that a meat eater will eat. No question. But when they've done studies for what sugar does to your system on vegetarians, it has almost a negligible effect. Sugar is a natural taste. We got bitter, sweet, sour, and salt. Those are the four basic tastes. When you become a vegetarian, one thing, by the way, is who has a sweet tooth in here? Can I just have a show of hands? Okay. If you switch your diet, I mean, your hand's going to go up. I'm really a sweet tooth because your taste buds purify. You ever talk to someone when those of you stop smoking, you taste your food much better. When you stop eating meat, you really start tasting your food. And so what happens is one of the natural tastes that come out is a sugar taste. As far as fat going into your system, once again, what did we say at the beginning? You know, like what are the charts talking about now? 10% of your food intake should be fat. It's just if you take in too much fat, you got a problem. You ever seen people that don't eat fat? I mean, they look horrible. They look emaciated. You know, their cheekbones are coming out. So you do need fat. It's just fat is like your slow-burning log in your fire. It has now been proven that your body stores up the foods. Why the meat industry used this, it said the meat has 8 essential amino acids. All right, so what Francis Mourelapé said, well, meat, yes, they want 8 essential amino acids. You can get that. But what happens now, if you don't take it in, then you're not going to have a complete food. Well, for a vegetarian, they can't get 8 essential amino acids in any one food. So what they had to do was, they said, well, what we're going to do is we're going to combine beans and rice. And beans and rice means you've got all the 8 essential amino acids. So you can eat a vegetarian diet and still get your 8 essential amino acids. They have now proven that this is false. Yes, you can eat your beans and rice, and that'll do okay. That'll get you your 8 amino acids together. However, your body stores up the acids until it's needed. Same thing with B12. Big concern. Vegetarians can't get B12. Well, first of all, at any one time in your body, you have an 8-year supply of B12. So, you know, it's going to take a long time for you to run out of that stuff. Plus, they have also proven that the B12 is manufactured from the bacteria in your intestines. We all know that, you know, one of the advantages of yogurt is it has acidophilus, which is your friendly bacteria. Well, the same thing here. We now are able to produce B12 internally. And you know something interesting? They have never found anyone on a vegetarian diet or a vegan diet that had B12 deficiency. Also, those of you that are still or maybe a little worried about protein, no one has ever died in the history of the world from protein deficiency. Never had one. They have died from malnutrition, but that's different from protein. Most of us get more than enough adequate protein. And I look at it this way. When you get off your own platform and say, well, I like to eat meat because, I look at it now as an ability or an opportunity to contribute to the longevity of another living entity. Someone that can actually get out there, or something that can, breathing creature that can live a little bit longer because I didn't guide my life because of my tongue. And that's all we really have to think about. Commitment. The best way in terms of nutrition is to think about someone else or something else. In other words, you're going to be healthier, so you're going to be around longer for your kids, for your family, for your company. If you're a good leader, a lot of you head up your own company. If you're a good individual, try to stick around, because there are not many good individuals that are here for a long period of time. So we need that. We need that little extra motivation. And I want to close just on one little story that occurred in Malaysia, because I talked to a group just like this for the Pacific Area Travel Association group, and there was a fellow in there who had cancer. And he had been diagnosed as probably having about another 5 or 6 months to live. And he didn't want to tell anyone. He didn't want to tell his family, didn't want to tell his boss, because his boss might get rid of him. There's always, every cancer patient thinks they're going to make it. Even though they might tell you they're not, there's still that little flicker of hope. And I just saw him a while ago, and his cancer is completely cured. He came up afterwards. I got this phone call. I got back to the room at the Pan Pacific Hotel in Kuala Lumpur, and he called me. He says, I got to talk to you right away. I've got a very important thing I have to discuss with you. So I went down and met with him in the lobby, and we talked about his problem. And I said, just go on a raw fruits and vegetables diet. That's all I can suggest from Dr. Agatha Thrash. And it all cured up. And to be able to do something like that, to be able to make that kind of contribution, is very exciting. And I hope that that's how we'll be able to continue to expand these programs, and that you'll go home and, you know, maybe just reassess kind of what you're eating, the direction you're taking. And you know, anyone who will take 3 hours out of their time and come to the Irvine Hilton to be part of this program tonight, it says something about you. It says something that either you care or you want to do something a little bit better. And for that, I really appreciate such a great attendance tonight. I apologize for it being a little warm, and some of you didn't have as comfortable a place to sit. But hopefully the knowledge will transcend any discomfort that you had. And I really wish you luck in your new path, and have a very enjoyable breakfast tomorrow morning. Thank you.
If you would like to obtain the books by Peter Burwash, write Peter Burwash International, 2203 Timberlock Place, Suite 126, The Woodlands, Texas, 77380.